Let's get some reaction to what we just heard from the White House and from the Secretary of Homeland Security. We're going to get reaction from someone who's been unexpectedly very vocal about this border policy, retired General Michael Hayden, former director of the CIA and the NSA, the National Security Agency. He's a CNN national security analyst. General Hayden, thanks so much for joining
thank
us.
Thank you, Wolf.
You listened very closely, yeah. We all did, to what Secretary Nielsen had to say. What was your reaction?
Disappointing. Frustrated. Look, this is a very complicated issue. But one of the things that concerned me over the weekend was evidence that we have lost the ability to even make semi-difficult decisions. We have lost the ability to govern ourselves. I get the border question is complicated, but it shouldn't be on, it should not be beyond our capacity to resolve it in a way that's broadly satisfactory for everyone concerned. And there you saw in full display for well over an hour. Imagine what the rest of the world now looks and views and judges what's going on in the world's greatest democracy.
Because a lot of people are watching, not only here in the United States, but around the world are saying, what's going on? Why is the United States taking 3- and 4- and 5-year-old kids away from their moms?
Yeah, and it was very clear, all right? It was very clear that these young people are being used as leverage to deter people from coming across the border, okay, but also used as leverage politically. They don't want the clean bill, simple solution. The euphemism is comprehensive reform, which means a far broader answer that politically is going to be very hard to get. But they seem insensitive then to what happens to these young folks.
You caused quite a stir over the weekend when you posted a picture, and I'll put it up on the screen, of the Birkenau death camp at Auschwitz. There it is right there. I visited there. You visited there. And then you wrote this. Other governments have separated mothers and children. Tell us why you decided to make this comparison.
Yeah, so I've been to Birkenau, all right? And I've walked up and down that railroad siding, and that's exactly what happened. That's where families were separated. And you know, Wolf, you've been there. You sit there, and it's hard to let the evil enter into you. It is so great. Now, I am not saying what's going on in our southern border is any way like what happened at Birkenau. Actually, there's a companion tweet to that. What I said to that was, as you walk through that portal, all right, it's impossible to casually assume civilization, civilized life is a given. So what I was trying to describe was something broader, even broader than what's going on the southern border. It's what's happening to us as a people. I showed the picture of Birkenau in 1944, but my story is Berlin, 1933, where you had a new government in power with a cult of personality, a cult of nativism, a cult of untruth, a cult where it was acceptable to punish the marginalized segments of society. Now, I'm not saying our needle's in the red. I'm not saying we're becoming Nazis. But Wolf, what I was trying to say was the needle's moving in the wrong direction. The way I described it to myself before I hit send was, the skies are darkening, and I want to send up a flare.
But you understand the controversy any comparison to the
Holocaust.
Yes, the kids were brought in the trains to Birkenau, which was at Auschwitz. I speak with some authority on this. My grandparents were murdered at Auschwitz, and my dad survived, but two of his brothers and two of his sisters were killed at Auschwitz. They were separated. They weren't separated to go to some other facility. They were separated to die.
Oh, I know.
They were killed.
Yes.
And so when you make the comparison to Auschwitz, that's such a powerful image, and you understand the criticism you're getting for that. As bad as this policy is, not Auschwitz.
I fully understand. And if that offended anyone, they have my deepest and most sincere apologies. But what I was trying to describe, Wolf, and actually what I tried to work with in the book that I just wrote, was that, you know, these things we take for granted shouldn't be taken for granted. The Germans are one of the most civilized people on earth, and yet they were capable of that because they didn't take great care. So again, I knew it would be controversial, but I felt a warning flare was necessary.
You're so concerned about what's going on.
Yeah.
And all of us are so concerned. We see these heartbreaking images, and it's so awful to see what's going on.
But it's beyond the images, and it's beyond this particular problem. As bad as this is symptomatic of something more broad in American society, I fear.
Tell us about the fears. So when you mentioned 1933 Germany, yeah. What are the fears that you see?
Well, I see a move towards nativism.
Here
in the United States, yes. Look, blood and soil, sounds familiar. I mean, that used to be unacceptable, and for God's sake.
That's what we heard at Charlottesville.
Right, and I'm not saying...
Jews will not replace us.
Right, and I'm not saying the president embraces that or the administration embraces that, but because of some things the president and the administration have done, Wolf, the center line of acceptable American discourse has changed. And now suddenly, that's not so far out there that you never hear it. It's tucked up here against the edge and moving more towards the center. That should be scary.
Your entire career was spent in the military and intelligence, and we're grateful to you for your service. Why are not more people coming out right now and speaking out against this policy as passionately, as strongly as you are?
Well, you know, I'm not alone. I mean, there are actually, quite surprisingly, a lot of folks with kind of my background, Jim Clapper, John Brennan, Phil Mudd, John McLaughlin, Mike Morrell, who are out there expressing this. Maybe it's because in our intelligence lives, we've seen the face of evil. Maybe in our intelligence lives, we've seen societies that should have been healthy turn very unhealthy. And maybe in our intelligence lives, we've recognized how fragile these things really are. Look, Wolf, I hate no one, but I'm scared.
When you say you're scared, is this the most frightening moment in your history now?
So I go around and I give talks to folks, and it's usually what keeps you awake at night. In other words, they want to know, what do I think are the most serious global problems? And you know the answer I give them now, Wolf? Us. We are the most destabilizing force in the world. We have lost. We are a credo nation. We have believed throughout our existence that you get to be an American by believing in certain things. I'm just not sure that's holding.
And so what I hear you saying, you've not seen anything like this in your career.
Not in my homeland. Now look, I've got some degrees in history. I know about the Know-Nothing Party. I know about the darkness in the 20s and the 30s. I get that. But in my personal life, I've not seen this.
So if the president is watching you right now, what's your message to President Trump?
Mr. President, do not use division as your tool of governance. Look to bring us together, not divide us. Actually, you're in a unique position. You can pull some people into coalition that no other president has had the ability to do.
General Hayden, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Appreciate it very much.